those who are online, जल्दी से हाई कर दीजिए चैट विंडो के अंदर सो दैट वी कैन स्टार्ट. प्लीज से हाई इन द चैट विंडो. आई होप दैट यू हैड अ ग्रेट डे टुडे. सो इन द प्रीवियस क्लास वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट प्रपोजिशंस. तो हमने पिछली क्लास में वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट प्रपोजिशंस. इन दिस क्लास ऑल्सो वी विल बी कंटिन्यूइंग विद द सेम टॉपिक दैट इज प्रपोजिशंस. तो प्रोपोजिशंस, इन केस ऑफ प्रोपोजिशंस आई थिंक वी डिस्कस्ड टिल सेटिस्फाइबिलिटी. हाय वर्षा, हरिका, प्रणीता, लक्ष्मी, दर्पण, अर्जुन, स्मिता, हेलो एवरीवन. सो इफ यू ऑल आर रेडी देन वी कैन स्टार्ट. आई गेस ऑल ऑफ यू आर रेडी, राइट? हाय देवेंद्र, प्रवीण. सो in the previous class we were discussing about propositions, and in propositions we discussed about the basic concepts of propositions, that is what is a proposition, what are biconditional statements, what are conditional statements, if then else. We have discussed about all these things in the previous class. Okay, now in this class we will be continuing with the same topic, that is propositions. So first of all we will be seeing how can we resolve, what are the things that we can deduce with the help of propositions, and then we will be looking at what is the countability, sorry, then we will be looking at the new topics related to the propositions. Okay, so I think we have already done this proposition satisfiability, and now in this class we will be starting with the rules of inference. Rules of inference. So what is the rules of inference? Is that you can deduce something new, some new information with the help of your old information. That is your rules of inference. Like for example, if I say that if today it will be raining, then I will go and play football. And then yes, it started raining, so I will go and play football, right? So rules of inference means given some information, what is the new information that you can find out, or what is the new information that you can deduce with the original given information. That is rules of inference. So as you can see here, an argument in proposition logic is a sequence of propositions. All but the final proposition is the argument is called premises, and the final proposition is called as a conclusion. So there's a terminology which is called as premise, and second terminology is conclusion. So premise and conclusion. So what do you mean by premise? Premises is something that, what is the information that is given? So whatever the information that is already given to you, that will be called as premises. And that information that you can deduce from the already given information, that will be called as a conclusion. And the argument can be valid, the argument can also be invalid. For example, an argument is valid if the truth of all its premises implies that the conclusion is true. And an argument form in proposition logic is a sequence of compound propositions involving propositional variables. And the argument form is valid no matter which particular propositions are substituted from the propositional variables in its premises, and the conclusion is true if the premises are all true. I don't think so you understood anything from this. So let me explain you with the help of an example. So this is just a theory which I have taken from the book, but you will understand it with the help of an example if I take examples for this. So as you can see here, we have two arguments. So the first argument is, if you have a current password, then you can log on to a network. So this is the first statement. This is some kind of argument that is given. And yes, you have a password, therefore you can log on to a network. So if you represent it with the help of a proposition, you say we can use the proposition P to represent you have a current password. This is a declarative statement, that is why it is a proposition. So we can use a variable P to represent you have a current password, and then we can use a variable Q to represent you can log on to a network. Now we already know that if P implies Q means if P then Q. This is P implies Q. So if P says you have a current password, and if Q says you can log on to the network, therefore P implies Q means if you have a current password, then you can log on to a network. This is something that you already know. Okay. Now, we say this is the first statement and this is the second statement which is true. The second statement says yes, you have a password, therefore you can log on to a network. So this is something called as conclusion. So these first two statements, these are the premises, and this statement is representing conclusion. Okay, Devendra, some in some certain point of time you can write theory, but I've already emailed you these PPTs, these presentations. I think already sent you on Telegram group, so you already have all these presentations. If you feel that you want to write something, you can obviously write. That is your choice. Okay. Good evening, Garima. So let's continue then. So generally, let me repeat this again. I mean, I feel I'm teaching very fast. So let me slow down my pace and let me repeat this again so that you will be able to understand it more properly or more thoroughly. Now, what we say here is that we can use a variable P to represent you have a current password. So this is a proposition. For this, I'm using a variable P. And you can log on to a network. For this proposition, you can use a variable Q. Now the arguments that we had. So the argument that you had is, if you have a current password, then you can log on to the network. So this is P and this is you can log on to the network is Q. So this first statement is P implies Q. And second statement says, yes, you have the password. So this is P. So it means P implies Q is the first statement. And this P is true. That means the first statement, the first portion is true that you have the password. Therefore, you can say you can log on to the network. Okay. So this comes with the help of this one. So basically, we are doing an AND operation here. AND operation means you have P implies Q. And P is true, therefore Q is true. Okay, so this is from this given statement. If you create a truth table of this, that we have a P implies Q, and if P is true, in that case, this P implies Q and P implies Q is a tautology, or you can say it is truth. Okay, so it will all have always have a truth value. Okay. So we say this form of argument is valid because whenever all its premises are true, whenever we say the premises are true, then the conclusion must also be true. Premises are true, then the conclusion will be true. Okay. I think you still could not understand this. So let me say it in a easier language or easier way. Generally what happens is, I am giving you a condition. Okay. Just say, for example, if two friends are talking with each other, this is the first friend, this is the first person, maybe his name is Rahul. This is the second person, and maybe her name is Shalini. So Rahul says, if you have the password, if you have the current password, then you can log on to the network. Rahul says to Shalini, if you have the current password, then you can log on to the network. Then Shalini says, yes, I have the password. So that means in the first statement is true. So he says, if you have the password, then you can log on to the network. Shalini says, yes, I have the password. Therefore, Rahul concludes, yes, then you can log on to the network. So this kind of conclusions we can deduce from a given propositions. So there are various rules of inference here that we use. So this way there are various rules of inference here. So the first rule is called as modus ponens theorem. So these names you should remember, because these names are going to be helpful even if you are going to study artificial intelligence. The same topic you are also going to study in artificial intelligence. So in AI also you are going to use these rules. So it is better that first of all you understand here, then understanding these rules in artificial intelligence, it will become very easy. Now, these rules of inference. So first rule says, if P implies Q is true and P is true, therefore Q is true. Okay, so this theorem is called as a modus ponens theorem. The second theorem says, if P implies Q is true and negation of Q is true, therefore negation of P will also be true. Again, I'm saying if P implies Q is true and negation of Q is true, therefore negation of P will also be true. This is Modus Tollens theorem. The third one is hypothetical syllogism. It says if P implies Q is true and Q implies R is true, therefore we can say P implies R will be true. The next theorem is disjunctive syllogism. It says if P or Q is true and negation of P is true, therefore Q will be true. Look at these theorems carefully. Look at all of them again. Take your time. Try to remember the names. And you can just do one thing. Write down this inference rule in your notebook, as well as write down the names. Because these inference rules plus the names, they are going to be very useful for you to solve the questions. Okay. So these rules are going to be useful when you are going to deduce some new information from already given information. If some information is already given and you have to find out, is there any new information that we can find out from the already given information? Then for that purpose, we are going to use these rules. Okay, there are various rules. So this is the first four rules, which is Modus Tollens theorem, Modus Tollens theorem, hypothetical syllogism and disjunctive syllogism. They are going to be very useful. So you can read it this way, these rules, that there's a statement given which is P implies Q. A statement is given that P implies Q. For example, if you have a password, then you can log on to your system. And we say, yes, you have a password, that yes, you have a password. So this is AND. Yes, you have a password. Therefore, you can say you can log on to your system. So this is how you can represent this information. I feel these are easy, but still, if you at any point of time, if you feel that you are not able to understand, just say to me, then I will explain it properly again. Okay. At any point of time, if you feel that you are not able to understand any topic, just write in the chat window. So these are again more rules. The next one is your addition rules. It says that if P is true, therefore P or Q will also be true. Obviously, if in case of OR, if first statement is true, the second statement will always be true. So that is called as addition theorem. Then we have simplification theorem. It says P and Q is true. So obviously P and Q will be true when both of them are true. Therefore we can say P will be true. The next one will be conjunction. Conjunction says if P is true and Q is true, therefore P and Q will be true. The next will be resolution. So see, all the first three are very obvious. These addition, simplification, conjunction, they are very, very obvious. Okay. Resolution is might be different. Resolution says if P or Q is true and negation of P or R is also true. So obviously here Q will be true and R will be true. P or Q is true and negation of P or R is also true. So obviously this can only happen when Q is also true as well as R is also true, right? So this kind of theorem is called as resolution. So this is another example. This is example based on these principles only. So first example is, if you have a conditional statement which is if it snows today, then we will go to skiing. So this is the first conditional statement. And we say the hypothesis is that it is snowing today. They says if it will snow today or if it snows today, then I will go skiing. And we say yes, it is snowing today, therefore we will go to skiing will be true. So this is from the theorem which is Modus Tollens theorem. Tollens theorem, it follows that the conclusion of the conditional statement will go skiing is true. This is just an example for the same. So then this is a second example. This is a mathematical theorem. It says if under root 2 is greater than 3/2, then under root 2 square will be greater than 3/2 square. And we know that under root 2 is obviously greater than 3/2. Consequently, we say that under root 2 square is equal to 2 greater than 3/2 whole square, which is equal to 9/4. So here basically we are identifying that whether the given argument is valid and determine whether its conclusion must be true because of the validity of the argument. Okay. So here you can see we have applied modus ponens theorem. Just read it once. See Harika, these equivalence, logical equivalences, these are very easy in the sense because they are very intuitive. If you know the concepts of Boolean algebra, so obviously you can easily remember them. They are just like concepts of Boolean algebra only. And in this entire preparation, you are going to follow the same concepts again and again. You are going to read the same concepts again and again. Okay. So here you can see what they are saying is, we have this statement which is, if under root 2 is greater than 3 by 2, then under root 2 square will be greater than 3 by 2 square. Okay. So this is the first statement. I can say this is the statement P is, the statement P is under root 2 greater than 3 by 2. Okay. And we say this is the statement Q. So statement Q is under root 2 square is greater than 3 by 2 square. Okay. So that means this becomes P implies Q. The first statement is P implies Q. Now we know what is P implies Q. We know what is P and we know what is Q. So this is P implies Q. Now here you can see under root 2 is greater than 3 by 2 is false. Then that means P is false. We say that if P implies Q is true, and we say if P is true, then we say that Q is true. But again here P is not true. They are giving P implies Q, but here P is not true, therefore Q will also not be true. This is what, this is the same thing that they are explaining. Okay. So again you can read, if under root 2 is greater than 3 by 2, then under root 2 square is greater than 3 by 2 whole square. Now this is P implies Q. And if we say that, we know that under root 2 is greater than 3 by 2. So if we say that under root 2 is greater than 3 by 2, if this first statement is true, then the second statement must also be true. But here you can see the first statement is not true. The first statement is false. Then second statement, obviously it will also be false. So here you can see under root 2 is greater than 3 by 2 is false. The premise under root 2 is greater than 3 by 2 is false. So obviously the second statement here, it will also be false. Okay. It's very easy. Just another example again. So here we have, state which rule of inference is the basis of the following argument. It is below freezing now, therefore it is either below freezing or raining now. So here you can see, this is just an addition rule. They are saying that it is below freezing now. If we say that we have P is, it is below freezing now. If P is, it is below freezing now. And second is, therefore, second is, it is either freezing, it is either below freezing or raining now. So this is, it is below freezing, this is P. And if we have Q, it is raining now. So this statement, which is therefore it is either freezing, below freezing or raining now, this is P or Q. And this is the statement which is P. Now the argument is, it is below freezing now, this is true. Therefore either it is below freezing or it is raining, because we already know that P is true. So here we already know P is true, therefore even if Q is false or even if Q is true, doesn't matter, it doesn't create any difference. Even if Q is false or Q is true, it doesn't create any difference, right? So this is just an addition rule. They are just representing additional rule here. Okay. So basically these examples are just showing the rules that I've shown you. They are just showing the rules only, nothing special. So this is another example, which is example number 4. Example number 4 says, it is below freezing and raining now. So that is, P and Q is true. Therefore, it is below freezing now will also be true, because P and Q is true. If both P and Q are true, then only this statement can be true. We already know that AND is true if both of them are true, right? OR is true if any one of them is true. AND is true if both of them are true. They are already saying it is freezing and raining now. So that means it is freezing is true, it is raining is true. Therefore, we can say it is freezing now is also true. Okay, so they are just deducing this information that yes, it is freezing now. This is simplification rule here. What is your confusion, Vijay? Please tell me your confusion. So they are not doing anything special. What they are doing is, they have taken these rules and they are giving some statements. For example, here they are giving a rule. For example, let us suppose this is addition rule. It says that if P is true, therefore P or Q will also be true. So the statement P is, it is freezing now. And this statement is, it is freezing now or it is raining now. So obviously it is freezing now. Obviously this statement will also be true. No, you will not get questions like this. These are just the basic rules. I mean, I'm just explaining the rules here. Questions will be very easy. The questions are much easier comparatively what we are doing. Okay, I'll show you some previous year questions. I have some good questions here. I'll show you some of the previous year questions, then you will understand what are the kind of questions you are going to get. Okay, don't worry, we will practice the questions also. So you'll see both questions as well as rules. Both of these things I'm going to cover. Okay. So this is another rule. As you can see here, this is hypothetical syllogism. It says, if it rains today, then we will not have a barbecue today. If we do not have a barbecue today, then we will have a barbecue tomorrow. So this is the statement. So therefore, if it rains today, then we will have a barbecue tomorrow. This is something information that you can, this is the information that you can find out. So we say, if we have a proposition P, if it rains today, this is a proposition P, we will not have a barbecue today. This is proposition Q. So we say P implies Q is true. This is what they are explaining, that if it rains today, then we will not have barbecue today. Now, if say we have a proposition R, that we will have a barbecue tomorrow. So this is, if we do not have a barbecue today, then we will have barbecue tomorrow. Therefore, we can say, if it rains today, we can have barbecue tomorrow. So these are just simple talks. I mean, these are just like simple talks that you and me are doing. If I'm giving you some statement, if I'm saying that we will bunk the college if Himanshu sir will teach in the classroom, right? Then another student says, if we bunk the college, then we go for a movie, right? Or he says, if Himanshu sir teaches today, then we'll go for a movie. So what is the conclusion? That obviously if Himanshu sir is coming, then you'll go for a movie. So this is kind of things that you can have a conclusion. I mean, you can give some statements and then you can find out some conclusion. And according to that only, we are creating some rules. We are saying, whatever the conversation is, I mean, whatever some information is provided, what is the new information that you can find out? This is what we are doing. Okay. So how can you use these rules of inference to build the argument? This is just an example. Those who are saying that they are not able to understand. So this is again a good example for that. So we have the premise here, if it is not sunny this afternoon and it is colder than yesterday. So it is not sunny this afternoon and it is colder than yesterday. So if I say it is not sunny this afternoon is P, it is colder than yesterday is Q. So first statement is P and Q. So a statement P and Q is given, which is true. Second statement is we will go swimming only if it is sunny. So here we have only if. So if I say that this we will go swimming, this is statement R. If we will go swimming, this is statement R. So this statement will be R implies P. Then we have if we do not go swimming, then we will take a canoe trip tomorrow. And if we take a canoe trip, then we will be home by sunset. So basically it is just like a conversation with two people. Maybe I am telling you today, if I am telling you that it is not sunny this afternoon, agar aaj dopahar mein aaj dhoop nahi niklegi, to it is colder than yesterday. To aaj jo hai, mausam jo hai, wo kal se zyada thanda hoga. So pehli statement hai, main aapse bolta hoon, agar aaj dhoop nahi niklegi, to aaj ka jo mausam hai, wo kal se thanda hoga. Agar aaj dhoop nahi niklegi, to hum swimming pe jayenge. Agar hum swimming par nahi gaye, then hum log canoe trip par jayenge. और अगर हम canoe trip लेते हैं तो हम शाम तक घर वापस आ जाएंगे. सो दिस इज़ सम इंफॉर्मेशन दैट इज़ गिवन. तो इससे हम क्या इन्फॉर्मेशन निकाल सकते हैं? सो न्यू इन्फॉर्मेशन इज़ कि हम शाम तक घर वापस आ जाएंगे, चाहे आज धूप निकले या फिर ना निकले. ओके, सो यू कैन आइडेंटिफाई दैट इट इज़ नॉट सनी दिस आफ्टरनून. सो दिस इज़ अ स्टेटमेंट विच इज़ गिवन कि यस, आज धूप नहीं निकली है, तो इसका मतलब है कि हम आज शाम तक घर वापस आ जाएंगे. दिस इज द काइंड ऑफ इन्फॉर्मेशन दैट यू कैन यूज. सो अगेन लेट मी शो यू हाउ वी बिल्ड आर्ग्यूमेंट विद दिस. सो लेट स्टेटमेंट पी इज इट इज नॉट सनी दिस आफ्टरनून. इट इज सनी दिस आफ्टरनून. स्टेटमेंट पी इज इट इज सनी दिस आफ्टरनून. व्हेन ही सेज इफ इट इज नॉट सनी, दैट मीन्स वी आर यूजिंग नेगेशन ऑफ पी. क्यू इज द प्रोपोजिशन इट इज कोल्डर देन यस्टरडे. सो द फर्स्ट स्टेटमेंट इज negation of P and Q means it is not sunny this afternoon and it is colder than yesterday. So this is a premise. So with this premise, because we are using and, this premise will be true, either negation of P will be true or Q will be true. So which is a simplification rule. So we can definitely say that it is not sunny this afternoon. Okay. So second statement is R, proposition R is we will go swimming. So here R implies P is if we will go swimming, then it is not sunny this afternoon. Or we will go swimming only if it is not sunny this afternoon. So this is your again a premise. So using a few statement, for example, we say negation of P is true and R implies P is true. So on both of them we can apply modus tollens theorem and we can say negation of R is also true. Negation of R means we will not go for swimming. And then we say next statement is statement S is we will take a canoe trip. So it says negation of R imply S means if we will not go swimming, then we will take a canoe trip. And we already know that negation of R is true. So according to 4 and 5, we can apply modus ponens theorem and we can say S will be true. And statement S is we will take a canoe trip. So this is true. And this next statement is S implies tree that if we take a canoe trip, then we will be home by sunset. So according to the 6 and 7, we can apply modus ponens theorem on that and we can say this T must be true. So this is a conclusion, and conclusion is saying that we will be home by sunset. So this is how you can use these theorems. Again, just understand it. Again, if you are not able to understand, please write again in the chat window. If you want me to explain this again, please write again. Please write in the chat window so that I can explain this again. Okay. So again, just see the message. Let me show it again. So this is, we are using the rules of inference to build arguments. We are using the rules of inference to build arguments. Arguments is that it is something like you are having a logical conversation with your friend, that there is some information that is given. There's a new information that you can deduce from the current information. Okay. So this is just like a logical intellectual conversation with your friends. You cannot use any extra information. You cannot suppose anything. There's some information which is given, and from that you can find out what is the new information that you find that it should be true. So there are some premises given. So this much is premise. From this line onwards, I mean from this line, this much is information that is given. So this given information is called as premises. It says, it is not sunny this afternoon and it is colder than yesterday. So this is the first statement that is given, and we say that this first statement is true. So here in this first statement, we use a word and. So if I say we have a proposition P, proposition P is it is not sunny this afternoon, and we have a proposition Q which is it is colder than yesterday. So this is P and Q. So this first statement is given and therefore it should be true. Second statement is given, we will go swimming only if it is sunny. So if I say it is sunny, that is P, then it is not sunny, that will be negation of P. So it is negation of P and Q. The first statement is negation of P and Q. And we say this is true. This is given as true because this is given in premises. The second statement is we will go swimming only if it is sunny. So only it is sunny is P. We will go swimming is, let us suppose it is R. So we say it is R implies P, and it is also true because it is given in the premises. This is the information which is already given. So we have to say that some information is given, and what is the new information you can find out. So this first statement will be true only if negation of P is true or negation of Q is also true. So this first sentence can only be true if this part is true and this part should also be true, because they are using and. And means both the parts should be true. So that means negation of P is true and Q is also true. So if negation of P is true, therefore P must be false. And they are saying the second sentence is also true. So what is the new information that you can find out? You can use it. Next information is, if you do not go swimming, then we will take a canoe trip. So if it, this statement is representing R, so this statement will be representing negation of R. It means if you do not go swimming, so it is negation of R implies we will take a canoe trip. This is S. So it is negation of R implies S. And we are saying this is true. And then if we take a canoe trip, then we will be home by sunset. So again, this is one more information which is given. So what we have to do is, there's some information is given and we have to find out what is the new information that you can deduce from them. So this is how we are building the argument and we are getting to the conclusion. So this one here, it is a conclusion. It is representing the conclusion. So again, you can see, let P is the proposition which is it is sunny this afternoon, and Q is the proposition it is colder than yesterday. So the first statement was it is not sunny today and it is colder than yesterday. So this can be represented by negation of P and Q. So this is the first statement, how this first statement can be represented. So this will be true because we are using and here. Therefore either negation of P must be true and negation of Q should also be true. If both of them are true, then only the first statement can be true. Therefore we can apply simplification rule on the first statement, and we can say that yes, negation of P should be true. Now we say that negation of P is true, and the second statement should is R implies P, which is if we go swimming then it is colder than yesterday. So we know that negation of P is true and R implies P is also true. Therefore, we can say negation of R is also true. Do you understand what I am trying to say here? Do you understand what I am trying to say? Just think again what I am trying to say. So those who are able to understand in Hindi, let me repeat it again in Hindi, and then again I'll also repeat the same in English. So yahan par given kya hai? Dekho, ye given hai ki hamare paas kuch hame information given hai. To yahan se is line se upar hamare paas kuch information given hai, aur ye hame conclusion jo humne nikala hai is information se. To information ye bolti hai ki aaj sunny nahi hai aur aaj kal se thanda hai. तो ये हो गया एंड. तो ये एंड क्यों है? बिकॉज ये स्टेटमेंट तभी ट्रू हो सकती है जब ये और ये दोनों पार्ट्स इसके ट्रू होने चाहिए. तो हमने बोला कि अगर दोनों पार्ट ट्रू है तो यानी कि फर्स्ट पार्ट है वो भी हमारा ट्रू हो सकता है. ठीक है, तो वो भी हमारा ट्रू है. उसके बाद सेकेंड स्टेटमेंट हमें गिवन है. सो सेकेंड स्टेटमेंट इज वी विल गो स्विमिंग ओनली इफ इट इज सनी. सो ये हो गया आर इफ, मतलब ये इम्प्लीकेशन हो गया, यानी कि अगर मैं इसको पी से रिप्रेजेंट करता हूँ या आर से रिप्रेजेंट करता हूँ, और इसको अगर मैं पी से रिप्रेजेंट करता हूँ तो ये हो गया आर इम्प्लाइज पी. सो हम बोलते हैं कि जो सेकेंड स्टेटमेंट है वो भी ट्रू है. तो इसका मतलब है सेकेंड स्टेटमेंट ट्रू तभी हो सकता है जब हमारे पास, अगर पी हमारे पास फॉल्स है तो आर हमारे पास, यहाँ पर यू शुड से आर भी हमारे पास फॉल्स होगा. ओके, let me tell you how this is true, how it is explained. Let me explain you properly again. See, P Q, P implies Q. So truth table values are true true, true false, false true, false false. So here it is true false true true. Okay, so P implies Q will be false only if P is true and Q is false. If P is false, then Q can have any value, it will always be true. Now we are saying that P is, it is sunny today. P is, it is sunny today. So this much, so sunny this afternoon. So this much will be negation of P. It is colder than yesterday. This much is Q. So first statement is negation of P and Q. First statement is negation of P and Q. So because we are using and here, it means negation of P is true. It means Q is also true. Roughly you can say P is false. If negation of P is true, then P is false. अगर P का negation, यानी कि P का उल्टा, इन P का negation अगर true है, तो P हमारे पास false होगा. And negation of P is true, and Q is true. तो first sentence से हम ये तीन चीज निकाल सकते हैं. We can find out these three things. What are the things? First sentence is if negation of P and Q, and we can say by looking at this, we can say P is false, negation of P is true, Q is true. Second sentence says, we will go swimming if this is R and this is P. So second sentence can be represented as R implies P. So R implies P means, if R is true, then P should also be true. If R is true, P cannot be false. If R is false, P can be true. If R is false, P can also be false. And we already know that P is false. Agar P false hai, so this is the only case which can happen where this statement will be true. So this is the only case. What is the case? That R should be false. Agar R hamare paas false hoga, then only this sentence can be true. Do you understand? सो फर्स्ट स्टेटमेंट से हमें पता चला कि P हमारे पास फॉल्स है. सेकंड स्टेटमेंट से हमने देखा कि हमारे पास ऑलरेडी हमें पता है कि P फॉल्स है, और ये पूरा स्टेटमेंट हमारा ट्रू है. तो इसका मतलब ये पूरा स्टेटमेंट ट्रू तभी हो सकता है जब हमारे पास R फॉल्स होगा, बिकॉज अगर R ट्रू है और P फॉल्स है तो ये हमारे पास इम्प्लीकेशन में वो रिजल्ट होता है फॉल्स. ओके, सो जो सेकेंड सेंटेंस है हमारे पास ये तभी ट्रू होगा व्हेन R इज फॉल्स. देयरफॉर वी कैन से R इज फॉल्स. सो फ्रॉम दिस वी कैन से R इज फॉल्स एंड नेगेशन ऑफ R इज ट्रू. तो सेकेंड सेंटेंस है वी कैन से R इज फॉल्स एंड नेगेशन ऑफ R इज ट्रू. If you take the third sentence, it says if we do not go swimming, then we will take a canoe trip. So if we do not go swimming, so this represents negation of R implies if we say we will take a canoe trip, if this is S, so this is S. So it says negation of R implies S. And we already know that R is false, so negation of R is true. Negation of R is true. So for this statement to be true, we should say thus S should also be true. So you can just see that if this negation of, this is a negation of R which is true, so this part should also be true, then only this is true. Otherwise, if negation of R is true and this part is false, so this will be false. So we already saying that negation of R is true, therefore here S should also be true. That means definitely we will take a canoe trip. From these three arguments we can say that we are taking canoe trip. We will be taking a canoe trip. We are not going for swimming. Okay. Then from the fourth argument, we are saying if we take a canoe trip, then we will be home by sunset. So definitely, it is clear from these three arguments that we are taking a canoe trip. So from the fourth argument, we can say definitely we will home by sunset. So this is how you can deduce new information from a already given information. So this same thing is represented using this table. As you can see here in this table, what is happening? That we are taking proposition P, proposition Q, proposition R, proposition S, and proposition T. So we are already taking these propositions, and we are just saying that these are the information that is given, these are the premises that is given. So according to these premises, what is the new information we can find out? And to find the new information, we are using simplification theorem, modus tollens theorem, modus ponens theorem, and here again we are using modus ponens theorem. So we are using the theorems to find a new information from the already given information. Is it clear with everyone? Is it clear? Any doubts? Now, if it is clear, then try to find information, extra information from this given premises. So try to create a reason for this, try to apply theorems on this, then I will show you the result. Take your time and try to apply theorems and results from this. So let me try and argue and reason with this statement. Let me try and reason with all of them. So first statement is, if you send an email message, then I will finish writing the program. So you send me an email message, right? So this is representing P. I will finish writing the program. This is representing Q. So the first statement is P implies Q. The first statement is P implies Q, and we say that P implies Q is true. Okay, so that means if you see the table of P implies Q, this is P, this is Q, this is P implies Q. Okay, so this is true, 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 false, false, true, false, false. So it is true, false, true, and true. So P implies Q is true in three cases. In these three cases, P implies Q is true, and P implies Q is false only when P is true and Q is false. So from this first statement, I cannot identify a lot of information, but still let us try to see from the second sentence. So the second sentence says, if you do not send me an email message, then I will go to sleep early. If you do not send me an email message, then I will go to sleep early. Okay. So that means if you do not send me an email message, this is representing negation of P. I will go to sleep early, this is representing Q. So we say P implies Q is true and negation of P implies, this is representing R. So we can say if P implies Q is true and this is negation of P implies R. First statement is P implies Q. Second statement is negation of P implies R. Now from the first statement, you can take a contrapositive of the first statement. If you remember what is contrapositive, contrapositive is here negation of Q implies negation of P. First statement is P implies Q. The contrapositive of the first statement is negation of Q implies negation of P. The second statement is negation of P implies R. So from these two statements we say negation of Q implies negation of P, negation of P implies R, therefore we can say negation of Q implies R is also true. So first two statements we can say negation of Q implies R is also true. So what is Q? Q is I will finish writing the message. So negation of Q is I will not finish writing the message, writing the program. So this statement says if I will not finish writing the program, then I will go to sleep early. From these first two statements, you can identify if I will not finish writing the program, then I will go to sleep early. Now take the next here. If I go to sleep early, then I will wake up feeling refreshed. So I will go to sleep early, this is R. I will wake up feeling refreshed, this is S. So we say R implies S. So we already know negation of Q implies R, R implies S, therefore we can identify negation of Q implies S. That means negation of Q is if I will not finish writing the program, then I will wake up feeling refreshed. So agar main program nahi finish karunga likhna, to main subah refresh aur fresh feel karunga. So this is what you can identify. So this information is if I do not finish writing the program, then I will wake up finish feeling refreshed. So this is how you can deduce this information from these given four statements, or these given three statements, first, second and third. From these three statements you can identify that if I do not finish writing the program, then I will wake up feeling refreshed. So this is how you can reason with the statements, how you can argue with the statements. I hope you understood this one, but again let me show you here in form of text. So you can use this information to identify new information again. So this is the same thing. We have P, you can send me an email message. We have Q is I will finish writing the program. So P implies Q is the premise. So I can take a contrapositive of the premise. Contrapositive will be negation of Q implies negation of P. And the next premise is I will go to sleep early. So negation of P implies R is it is if you do not send me an email message, then I will go to sleep early. Okay. Again, you can apply hypothetical syllogism on this. That is negation of Q implies negation of P implies R. So on this, you can apply hypothetical syllogism. So you can prove that R implies S. So this is hypothetical syllogism. You can prove that Q implies negation of Q implies R. And we already know that R implies S. So we can say negation of Q implies S. So using hypothetical syllogism. And this is how you can prove that if he is not going to finish writing the program, then he will wake up feeling refreshed. Okay. Devendra, contrapositive is not required, but again, according to my argument, whatever I wanted to prove, according to that only I have taken the contrapositive. But again, taking the contrapositive always is not, necessary here. So according to your requirement, just like mathematical formulas, which formula you have to apply, it depends with practice only. So you can check out 2, 3, 4 different examples and then you can see how you can practice, okay? I hope this much is clear with everyone. Is there anyone who is having any doubts with this? I think I've answered why we've taken the contrapositive. So we have taken the contrapositive because contrapositive solves our problem. I mean, it helps us reason with the statements, but without contrapositive also you can resolve. Sometimes it's just like mathematical formulas. You have to apply which mathematical formula is required. Okay, fine. So next is fallacies. So some common fallacies arise in incorrect arguments. So for example, here this is not a tautology. So because when P is false, then Q is true. In that case, it will not be a tautology. But again, we'll see what is fallacy later on. So I'm just skipping this fallacy part. Okay, we'll see that. Just read it once. It is just a theory because this is not going to be there in your solutions. Yes, we have taken contrapositive to make some relation. So just read this statement and tell me what you understand with fallacies. Read this entire statement, whatever written on the screen, and tell me what you understand from this. So fallacy is basically incorrect reasoning. If you are not doing a correct reasoning, that is called as fallacy. Okay. Good. Chalo, let's continue then. So now the next topic is predicates and quantifiers. So predicates and quantifiers, basically sometimes you cannot, you know, you're talking about bulk of things, or maybe you're talking about one thing in a bulk of things. I mean, sometimes you have a lot of things where you can count. So for things where you can count or where many things are mentioned, in that case you cannot use propositions to represent all of them. So in that case we use quantifiers. Okay, so we have multiple quantifiers, but the most common quantifiers is for all and there exist. So we have a symbol which is for all, and we have a symbol which is there exists. Okay, so you can read out, propositional logic cannot adequately express the meaning of all statements in mathematics in natural language. For example, every computer connected to the university network is functioning properly. So this is, every computer connected in the university network is functioning properly. So they are talking about all the computers. You can say, for all computers which are connected to the university network implies they are functioning properly, right? But if we talk about one computer out of all the computers, maybe that computer is Math 3, this is the name of a computer, right? So if we can talk about, there exists a system Math 3 which is connected to the university network which is functioning properly, right? So this is, again, we are talking about one thing out of a group of things, because no rules or propositions allow us to conclude the truth of this statement. There are many statements for where the simple rules of propositions you are not able to apply. In that case, we use predicates and quantifiers. I mean to say, let me repeat this again in Hindi. कई बार ऐसा होता है कि आपके पास जो predicates और जो आपके propositions हैं, let me repeat it properly again. आपके पास कई बार propositions होते हैं, तो propositions से आप सब कुछ properly represent नहीं कर पाते. उस केस में जहाँ पर हमें क्वांटिफिकेशन करना है, यानी कि कुछ काउंट करना है, या फिर कई सारी चीज़ों में से आप किसी एक चीज़ के बारे में बात कर रहे हो, या फिर हमें किसी एक को पॉइंट आउट करना है आउट ऑफ अ ग्रुप ऑफ थिंग्स, या हम पूरे ग्रुप की बात कर रहे हैं, सो इन दैट केस वी नीड समथिंग जिससे हम क्वांटिफाई कर सकें, यानी कि उसको काउंट कर सकें, या कोई नंबरिंग तरह से उसको हम लोग दे सकें. अब यहाँ पर जैसे कि हमारे पास पहला एग्जांपल है एवरी कंप्यूटर कनेक्टेड टू द नेटवर्क इज फंक्शनिंग प्रॉपरली. सो एवरी कंप्यूटर दैट इज कनेक्टेड टू द नेटवर्क इज फंक्शनिंग प्रॉपरली, दैट मीन्स वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट अ ग्रुप ऑफ कंप्यूटर्स. हम एक ग्रुप की बात कर रहे हैं. लेकिन अगर मैं बोलता हूँ उस ग्रुप में से एक कंप्यूटर हमारे पास है मैथ्स 3, सो मैथ्स 3 इज नॉट फंक्शनिंग प्रॉपरली, या फिर मैथ्स 3 इज फंक्शनिंग प्रॉपरली, सो वी कैन से देयर एग्जिस्ट अ कंप्यूटर मैथ्स 3 इन द ग्रुप ऑफ कंप्यूटर नेटवर्क्स विच इज़ नॉट फंक्शनिंग प्रॉपरली. सो इस तरह के अगर हमें कुछ स्टेटमेंट्स को देना है तो उसके लिए वी नीड क्वांटिफायर्स, प्रेडिकेट्स एंड क्वांटिफायर्स. सो हेयर कैन सी वेयर मैथ्स 3 इज वन ऑफ द कंप्यूटर्स कैन कनेक्टेड टू द यूनिवर्सिटी नेटवर्क. Likewise, we can not use the rules of proposition logic to conclude the form of the statement CS2 is under attack by an intruder, where CS2 is the name of the computer. So you can say in this entire university network, CS2 is the name of a computer. So we want to say that there exists a computer CS2 in the university network which is under attack by an intruder. So this is a proposition. So we need a proposition, we need a way to represent one thing, or we need a way to point out one thing out of many things. So for example, there is a computer on the university network that is under attack by an intruder. So this is how you can use identify from this. Okay. Let me show you with the help of example. So what are predicates? Predicates are the statements which are involving variables. So for example, if I say we have 2 + 4 = 7. Now 2 + 4 = 7, this is a declarative statement. That is why it is representing a proposition. If I say 2 + x = 5. Now 2 + x = 5, it is not a declarative statement. Why? Because it is having a variable x which can take multiple values. Therefore, we can say it is not a proposition. So proposition is always a declarative statement. And here, because of this variable x, it is not a declarative statement at all. Now you can see statements which are involving variables, they are called as predicates. Propositions do not have variables, but predicates can have variable. For example, x is greater than 3, x is equal to y plus 3, x plus y is equal to z. So here we have x is a variable, y is a variable, z is a variable, and these are statements. So for these statements where we have variables, they will be called as predicates. For example, computer x is under attack by an intruder, where x can be any computer. Computer x is functioning properly, where x can be any computer, we can mention what is a computer. Okay. So these statements are neither true nor false, because if the values are not specified, then you cannot identify their truthness. Again, I'm saying, if you give an exact value to that statement, for example, here I have given an exact value 2 + 4 = 7. Now here 2 + 4 is not equal to 7, so this proposition is false because there are exact values. But when you use a variables like this, now these variables do not have exact values. That is why for this statement we cannot say it is true or false unless the value of x is not given. If the value of x is given, then we can definitely say whether the statement will be true or whether the statement will be false. So for example, here you can say statement is x is greater than or equal to 3. So here we have two parts. First part is your x. X is a variable, and this variable will be called as a subject. And here the second part, which is greater than 3, this greater than 3 is the predicate. So predicate refers to the property that the subject of the statement can have. Okay. So x is greater than 3, we can represent by px such that x is greater than 3. So just like in case of propositions, we use variables. We use variables like P, Q, R, S, T. In the same way, we can represent predicates with the help of proposition functions. So this is representing a propositional function. So here you can see the statement PX is also said to be the value of the proposition function P at X. Okay. So once we assign the value of this X to this proposition P, to this statement, then this will become a proposition. What do I mean to say by this is, dekho, we can say X greater than 3, or we can say 4X plus 5Y is equal to 7. Now if we have a statement, listen to this carefully, if you have a statement 4X plus 5Y is equal to 7, now this statement here, it is not a proposition. Why? Because for this X and Y, they are variables. They can have any value. So 4X plus 5Y is equal to 7. Ye jo statement hai, ye proposition nahi hai. Ye proposition kyun nahi hai? Because yahan par X aur Y variables hain. Now, in this case, the variables which are X and Y, these variables are called as subjects. In variables ko hum bolenge subject. इसके अलावा जो भी पार्ट हमारे पास यहाँ पर बच जाता है उसको हम बोलेंगे प्रेडिकेट. जैसे कि हमारे पास x greater than 3 है, तो यहाँ पर x सब्जेक्ट है, greater than 3 प्रेडिकेट है. तो हमारे पास दो पार्ट जाते हैं, एक होता है सब्जेक्ट, एक होता है प्रेडिकेट. अब इस तरह की जो स्टेटमेंट्स है प्रोपोजिशंस नहीं है. दिस स्टेटमेंट्स आर नॉट प्रोपोजिशंस. द रीजन इज बिकॉज हियर x इज अ वेरिएबल एंड हियर x एंड y बोथ आर वेरिएबल्स. Now we can represent these statements with the help of a proposition function like px such that x is greater than 3, and here p of x comma y such that 4x plus 5y is equal to 7. Now this statement can become a proposition if you specify the value of x. This statement can also become a proposition if you specify the value of x and y. So ye jo statement hai ye ek proposition ban jayegi agar aap yahan par x aur y ki value ko specify करते हैं. अगर आप यहां पर x और y की वैल्यू को स्पेसिफाई नहीं करेंगे देन दिस विल नॉट बी अ प्रोपोजिशन. सो दिस इज रिप्रेजेंटिंग अ प्रोपोजिशन फंक्शन वेयर इफ यू इंसर्ट द वैल्यू ऑफ x एंड इफ यू इंसर्ट द वैल्यू ऑफ y देन दिस विल बिकम अ प्रोपोजिशन. सो दिस इज कॉल्ड एज प्रोपोजिशन फंक्शन. ओके. सो हियर कैन से वी कैन डिनोट द स्टेटमेंट x इज ग्रेटर देन 3 बाय px वेयर p डिनोट्स द प्रेडिकेट इज ग्रेटर देन 3 एंड x इज द variable. So here px, p denotes the predicate greater than 3 and x denotes this variable. Okay. Once a value has been assigned to the variable x, the statement px becomes a proposition and has a truth value. So once you assigned a value to this variable x, it will become a proposition. This is an example here. So here you can see, let px denote the statement x greater than 3. So here px is denoting the statement x greater than 3. Now if we say about p4, so p4 is a proposition. If we say about p2, here p2 is also a proposition where 4 is the value of x here. So this will become 4 is greater than 3 and this will become 2 is greater than 3, where the first P4, this is a true proposition and this is a false proposition because 2 is not greater than 3. Okay. Let me take more examples. So let AX denote the statement computer X is under attack by an intruder. So where X here is a subject, computer is under attack by an intruder, this is the predicate. So if you insert the value of x here, so this is a, here is a predicate, x here is a subject. So here a is representing computer is under attack by an intruder, x is representing the name of the computer. Suppose that we have only two computers in the campus, which is CS2 and Maths1. So if I say a of CS1, that means computer CS1 is under attack by an intruder. If I say A of CS2, That means computer CS2 is under attack by an intruder. If I say A of maths 1, that means computer math 1 is under attack by an intruder. But if, for example, CS1 is not present in the network, so as they said, the only CS2 and maths 2 are currently under attack. So that means if CS1 is not under attack, so this means this is a false proposition, this is a true proposition, and this is also a true proposition. Okay. So because this is not under attack, so you can say this proposition is false, this proposition 2 true, and this proposition is also true. So you can see, you can still give some values to these predicates. Okay. Let me show you more examples. So if we have the statement which is x is equal to y plus 3. So here x and y, they are variables, hence this is not a proposition. You can represent it by the proposition function, which is q of x comma y, where x and y is subject and q is a predicate, which is equal to plus 3. So if I insert some values, if I insert q of 1 comma 2, therefore the value of x is 1 and value of y is 2. So the statement will become 1 is equal to 2 plus 3, which is now a proposition, and the value of this proposition is false. Again, if I can say q of 3 comma 0, so the value of x is 3, the value of y is 0, so we have the proposition which is 3 is equal to 0 plus 3, which is a true proposition. Okay. Again, this is the same examples. You can, I've given you the PPT or presentation, you can read the same example from the presentation itself later on. This is your work, this is your homework. The next top statement here is quantifiers. What are quantifiers? So quantifiers, quantification expresses the extent to which a predicate is true over a range of elements. When we give a range of elements, then it will be quantified, or you can say this, we'll say it as a quantifier or quantification. Just for an example, if I say 4x plus 4x is greater than 17. So if I say the range of x is 0, 1, 2 and 3, even 4, but x cannot be 5, 6, 7, 8 and so on. So these values cannot be there. The value of x can be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So I have given a range. So for that we use quantifiers, or you can say quantification. So for example, if we have some words like all, some, many, none, few, they are used for quantification in the English language. So we have basically two major kinds of quantification here. One is the universal quantifier, a second is the existential quantifier. So universal quantifier is which exists for all. Existential for universal is just like for all. Existential is there exist. So if we say for all x, x is greater than y. So this is for the entire range, entire all the elements, for all the elements. Or we can say there exists an element x such that x is greater than y. So here talking about one element, here talking about all the elements. So universal quantifiers is about all the elements. Existential quantifier means we are talking about one element out of all the elements. Okay. So now we know what is predicates, we know what is quantifiers. If you combine both predicate and quantifier, that is called as predicate calculus. It will be called as a predicate calculus. Okay. Any doubt till now? Is there any doubt that you have? So this first chapter is actually this kind of a theory only. So that is why I'm teaching from presentation PPT. But I feel a lot of unnecessary theory that we have to read. So it's better to create a PPT like this. Okay. If you have any doubt, please ask me, please tell me, so that I can resolve your doubt. Aapki apatti, vipatti, parishani, usko dur karne ki zarur koshish karunga. At any point of time, if you feel that you are not able to understand, please please do not hesitate to stop me and ask me again. Yes, please stop me and ask me again. If I'm teaching fast, please stop me and ask me, sir, please slow, teach slow. Because I feel all of you are still just starting, because aap abhi start hi kar rahe hain. So you might feel some issues, some difficulty. So it is better that if you are facing some difficulty, if you are facing some issues, just stop me there and ask me, and I will answer your doubts, problems or issues, whatever it is. I will try to answer all of them. Okay? तो कभी भी कोई भी परेशानी आए, just stop me and ask me. ऐसा नहीं करना आपको कि just keeping that problem by yourself and बाद में बहुत बड़ी problem create हो जाए. Okay? So this is the example of universal quantifier. So universal quantifier is, for example, px for all values of x in the domain. So universal quantifier is represented by this symbol, which is for all. Generally we write it as for all, we write it as for all, like this. So whatever the way you are writing, that is your choice. So if I say we have for all x px, so that means px for all values of x. So if I say px represents x greater than 3, so that means for all x, x greater than 3. This is about all the elements in the range. So this is called as universal quantifier. So we can read it as for all x, px, for all x, px, or yafir for every x, px. Either you read it this way or you can read it this way. For any element for which this is not true, we call it as counter example. I mean, if you're talking about all the elements, for example, for all the people in the world, this thing holds true. If there exists one people for which this thing does not hold true, then it will be a counter example. Okay? For example, we say for all x, where x represents human beings. For all human beings have two legs. Right, so we are talking about entire human species, that entire human species have two legs. If there is someone in the whole world who is having three legs, so for that purpose, for that person, this for all statement will become false, and that person will be called as a counter example. Counter for example of whatever we said. So statement is for all x px is, px is true for every x. Okay. And there exists a x px, that is, there is an x for which px is 2. So we can say there exists a human who is having 3 legs. Okay. So this is when true is px is true for every element. So here x is true for n element. Yeah, that means here we are talking about one element. But when it is false, so there is an n x for which px is false. That is, this x is a counter example. So here px is false for every x. Okay, so you can see this way. So this is true for everyone but false for one. This is true for one but false for everyone. Okay, fit and fine. We will see that, no issues. Next one is, let px be the statement x plus 1 greater than x. So it is the truth value of the quantification for all x px, where the domain consists of all real number. So here we have x plus 1 is greater than x. So first of all, jaldi se mujhe bata dijiye, what is a real number? What is a real number? Just write in the chat window, what is a real number? रियल नंबर क्या होती है, किस नंबर को आप रियल नंबर बोलेंगे? सो यू सेड नंबर्स विद डेसिमल पॉइंट्स आर कॉल्ड एज रियल नंबर्स, एनी अदर डेफिनेशन? So real numbers are the numbers with continuous quantities, okay? Rational and irrational, okay? Just read in the chat window. P by Q form is not a real number. So real numbers are the numbers which can be represented along a line. Agar aap jin numbers ko ek line ke along represent kar sakte ho, they are called as real numbers. They are not in P by Q form. Real numbers are continuous. Real numbers are not in P by Q form. Okay. So if I say that px be the statement as x plus 1 is equal to x is greater than x. So for all the real numbers, if you take any number, even if the number is 1.5543 plus 1 is greater than 1.5543, for all the real numbers this statement will true hold. Therefore for all x px this statement will be true, it will be correct. But if I take this example here, x less than 2, if I say qx be the statement which is x less than 2, so this and they are talking about the quantification for all x qx. Now even the number 7 is also a real number, so number 7 is less than 2, this is not correct, this is false. But number 1 is less than 2, this is correct. So they are talking about for all x. For a few number s, for a few x this statement might be true, but there are many x that are existing for which the statement is false. Therefore you say for all x qx this is false. Okay. So this is the next example here. Suppose that px is x square greater than 0. To show that the statement for all x px is false, where universe of discourse consists of all integers, we can give a counter example. And so you can just read these examples. Read this example. This is just an example. So here they are telling that we have a statement which is px. Px is x square greater than 0 for all in x which is an integer. For all x which are integers. Px, where x square is greater than 0 for all x which are integers. So for example, if you take integer as minus 2, minus 2 is a negative number. So if you 2 minus 2 square, that is greater than 0. Yes, because 4 is greater than 0. If you take 2, so 2 square is also greater than 0. So 4 is greater than 0, right? But there exists one integer. There exists exactly one integer. That one integer is 0. So if you take 0 square, so 0 square is not greater than 0. That means if I talking about for all, so we have one counter example. The one counter example is if the value of x is 0, so this statement will be false. Otherwise this statement is true. So for we have one exactly one counter example where this statement is false. So that means if I'm talking about for all means agar hum us domain mein se sabhi elements ko individually le, so that means for all should be true for every element in the domain. For example, if the domain is the set of integers, so that predicate should be true for every element in the set of integers. So it should be true for and of every element. So px1 and px2 and px3, so this should be true, this should be true, this should be true, this should be true, this should be true. If all of them are true, then this entire statement is true, otherwise this statement is false. Is it clear? So for every statement here it should be true, otherwise it is false. So just for example purpose, what is the truth value of for all x where x square is greater than x? If the domain consists of all real numbers, so they are saying for all x where x square is greater than or equal to x, where x is a real number. Now you tell me whether this is true or false. जल्दी से कमेंट बॉक्स के अंदर, चैट विंडो के अंदर बता दीजिए वेदर इट इज़ ट्रू और फॉल्स. क्या ये ट्रू है या फिर फॉल्स है? आई नीड आंसर्स. इज इट ट्रू और फॉल्स? जो दोस्त हुआ सेइंग ट्रू जल्दी से बता दीजिए. दोस्त हुआ सेइंग ट्रू प्लीज कमेंट ऑन द चैट विंडो. माय डियर वेरी स्मार्ट पीपल, आई लव यू ऑल, बट दिस इज फॉल्स. व्हाई दिस इज फॉल्स? इफ यू सी हियर, एक्स इज अ रियल नंबर. Real number means it can also be having point values. So if I take, let x is equal to 0.5. Now this 0.5 is still a real number. 0.5 exists in the real number. So we have this statement which is 0.5 square is greater than equal to x, or 0.5 square is greater than equal to 0.5. So if you take 0.5 square, so this value will be 0.25 is greater than or equal to 0.5, which is false. So this is true only if x is greater than or equal to true. But if x is less than or equal to, sorry, this is true only if x is greater than or equal to 1. But if x is less than or equal to 1, that means if we have the value of x which is between 0 and 1 but not even equal to 1 and not equal to 0, any value which is, for example, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, if you take these values and you try to apply this on these values, so this will be false. Okay, so you can clearly see if you take the value of x which is less than 1, so square of that number will be less than lesser. So square of 0.5 will be 0.25, square of 0.1 is 0.01. so then this will be false. Is it clear? So just for simplicity purposes, if I take x is equal to 1 by 2, which is 0.5, so if I take 1 by 2 whole square, it is not greater than equal to 1 by 2. So 1 by 2 whole square is 1 by 4, is not greater than equal to 1 by 2. So then it is why we can say that this is false. So this is a proof that it is false. I hope you understood this one. Any doubts, my dear Arjun Reddy? How many of you have seen the movie Kabir Singh? So Kabir Singh movie is based on a South Indian movie which is Arjun Reddy. So Arjun Singh, your name reminds me of Arjun Reddy. You guys are so smart, so intelligent, super cool, super chill. Next one is your existential quantifier. Existential quantifier are represented by their exist. So it is E, or you can say mirror image of E. It says there exists an X, PX. That means in the entire domain, there will be at least one value for which px is true. Okay, so this is called as existential quantifier. Yes, beautiful movie. So the existential quantification of px is the proposition there exists an element x in the domain such that px. That means for one element x, the domain should be true. So for this predicate should be true. Okay, I don't understand Telugu and Tamil. Chalo, no problem. So here this is given an example. There is an x such that px, there is at least one x such that px, or for some x px. So this is how we represent there exist. I'll take an example here. So let px denote the statement x greater than 3. What is the truth value of the quantification? There exists a px, there exists an x px. So here you can see we take any number. If I say x is the set of real numbers, so there might be some real numbers which are less than 3, there might be some real numbers which are greater than 3. So this statement x is greater than 3 is applicable or valid for all the real numbers which are greater than 3. So for example, real number 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, for all these real numbers this statement is true. But for the real numbers which are less than 3, for example 2.5, 2.6, 2, 1, 0.5, for all these real numbers this statement is false. If we write it that there exists an x px where x is a real number, so if it is true for at least one value, it can be true for more than one values, but if it is true for at least one value, so this statement will be true, right? Easy. This is also easy, right? I hope you understood it. In the same way, this is again an example. Let qx denote the statement x is equal to x plus 1. What is the truth value of the quantification? There exists an x, qx, where the domain consists of all real numbers. So there will be at least one real number. If for at least one real number this statement is true, so it will, there exists an x, qx will be true. So if I say, if I take any real number, so real numbers are basically greater than, so if I take any real number, for any real number this statement will never be true. You can take any number whatsoever, even if you take 0.5, so 0.5 is equal to 0.5 plus 1, that will never be true. This statement can never be true for any real number whatsoever. That is why this, there exists an x, qx is false. If you can prove it true for at least one statement, so this will be true for every statement. Sorry, if you can prove for at least one statement, so we can say there exists x, qx will be true. So when we say there exists, so there exists means we have to apply or. So px1 or px2 or px3 up to so on, pxn. So this is for or, okay? So in the same way, we have a uniqueness quantifier. We do not use actually uniqueness quantifier. Uniqueness quantifier is denoted by there exist and then this exclamation mark, or there exist exactly one. So uniqueness quantifier is if a particular predicate is true for exactly one element, that is a single unique element, then we say it is a uniqueness quantifier. We generally do not use the uniqueness quantifier because it is not required. That is why we do not even teach it mostly in the classroom. So when the PPT is given, this is written. You can read it from the PPT, but I think it is not required for your exam. So you can just understand, you should just know what is a uniqueness quantifier, because uniqueness quantifier should be true for exactly one value, not more than one value. For example, if we have x minus 1 is equal to 0. So this is true for exactly one value where the value of x is 1. If you take any other value for x, this can never be true. So if a particular predicate is true for exactly one value, so that is a unique value. Hence we say it is, there exists a uniqueness quantifier. So which is either existential quantifier with an exclamation mark or existential quantifier with the value 1. So then we say it is true for only one value, which is uniqueness quantifier. Okay. And there are also quantifiers which are for restricted domain. Restricted domain means we have to tell the domain that for this domain this will be true. For example, here we say the statement is x square greater than 0. So we say this statement is true for all x which are less than 0. For example, here this is one statement. This is one statement. This is second statement. It is So this is a statement which is for all x less than 0, x square is greater than 0. This is a statement. For all the value of x, we have putting a constraint that x should be less than 0. That means we are dividing the domain. So we are selecting some elements in the domain, we are restricting the domain. Then we say it is a restricted domain, quantifiers with a restricted domain. For example, here you can see there exists a z for all, there exists a z greater than 0 where z square is equal to 2. So here we applied there exists and here we applied for all. So you can even restrict the domains with quantifiers. So next is your precedence of quantifiers. So here we can see for all and their exist have higher precedence. For example, we can use disjunction, we can use conjunction, we can use implication. So we can say for all x, px implies qx. If you have something like this, or you can say for all x, px and qx. We can also say for all x, px or qx. Or you can say there exists an x, px implies qx. So basically you can use this these operators from propositional logic even in this with the help of quantifiers, and these quantifiers have higher precedence than all the logical operators. So logical operators like and, or, implication, double implication, and you have XOR. So this is, they are having higher precedence as compared to them. For example, if you have for all x px, for all qx. So sorry, for all x px or qx. So here this for all x is only applicable on px. It is not applicable on qx. So if we have to write with qx, so we have to write for all x, opening brackets, px or qx. Either you have to write it this way, or you have to write it as for all x px or for all x qx. So either you have to write it this way or you have to write it this way, but again both of them are having different meanings. So this is having a different meaning and this statement is also having a different meaning. So I'll show you the meanings later on, but you just have to identify, you just have to understand that for all and their exist have higher precedence as compared to your logical operators. Any doubts in this? So let me show you some previous year questions based on this. You can see what are the different kinds of questions they have already asked. But okay, before that, let me cover this first of all. De Morgan's law before taking the previous year questions. We'll give a break after some time. I don't think so there's any requirement of giving a break, because hardly we have to continue for, I think in half an hour this entire topic will be finished. Everything will be finished in half an hour. Okay. So next is De Morgan's law. You can apply De Morgan's law on them. For example, here you can see if you have negation of there exists an x px. So equivalent statement is for all x negation of px. So this is important. You should know this. This is very important. While solving the questions, you should know how to apply De Morgan's law on them. So if you have negation of for all x px, negation is negation is here, right? So negation of for all x px, if you apply De Morgan's law, it will be there exists an x negation of px. So here even you can apply De Morgan's law on these quantifiers. So you can write it down in your notebook, by the way. It will be important later on for solving the question. This is required. So you should write it down in your notebook. This is important. Write it down. Garima, are you present in the live streaming? Jay Gupta and Garima, are you there? So next is negating the quantifier. For example, every student in your class has taken a course in calculus. So we can represent it by for all x px, where x represents student. So for all x px means for every student x in your class has taken a calculus. So for every student we have taken x. So we can say x has taken the course in calculus. So if I take negation of this, so it will be there exists a student x in your class who has not taken calculus. So if you take x has taken calculus, So negation is, it is not the case that every student in your class has taken calculus, which is equivalent to, there is a student in your class who has not taken calculus. So if you take this, it is important. If you take a negation of this, this statement represents every student in your class has taken calculus. If you take a negation of this, so there exists a student in your class who has not taken calculus. So that will be negation of this statement. So you can write down this result in your notebook. So negation of for all x px is equivalent to there exists an x, negation of px. It is important, you should not miss it. Without, if you skip this part, then you will not be able to solve questions. So this is again for existential quantifier. So for example, there is a student in your class who has taken a course in calculus, which is represented by there exists an x, qx. So if I take a negation of this, so negation will be every student in your class who has not, every student in this class has not taken calculus. So the negation of this will be for all x, negation of qx. So this result is important. Without seeing this result, you will not be able to solve the questions. So it is very, very important. So in the same way, if you have, there is an honest politician saying all Americans eat cheeseburger. So if I say there is an honest politician, so I can represent by X is an honest politician. So we can represent this statement by PX, where P means is an honest politician, X is the value. So we can say there exists an X such that X is a honest politician. This is there exist. If I take negation of this, so negation of there exists an X PX, it will be for all X negation of PX. So it will be saying there does not exist an honest politician. Yani ki, or you can say if PX represents X an honest politician, negation of PX represent X is not an honest politician. It says for all X. So you can say for all X, X is not an honest politician. Or simply you can say this honest politicians does not exist. So the negation of this statement will be honest politicians does not exist. Next is all Americans eat cheeseburger. Next is all Americans eat cheeseburger. So I can say here X eats cheeseburger, where X is an American, where X is an American. So I can say for all X, if I say I represent it by CX, so I can say for all X CX, where X is an American. So it means all Americans eat cheeseburger. If I take a negation of this, so negation will be there exists an X, negation of CX. That means there exists an American who does not eat cheeseburger. So it means the first statement means all Americans eat cheeseburger. This statement means there exists an American who does not eat cheeseburger. So this way you can use it. So these examples and everything I've taken from Kenneth H. Rosen book. So you can read this everything from Kenneth H. Rosen itself. Okay. I hope this example is clear with all of you and you are able to understand this properly. If there's any doubt, please tell me. Any apatti, vipatti, sampatti problem? Koi pareshani hai to batayega. So this is the next example. What are the negations of the statement for all x, x square is greater than x and there exists an x such that x square is equal to 2. So you can take a negation of them. So for example, the first example is for all x, x square is greater than x. If I take negation of for all x, x square is greater than x, so this will be there exists an x, which is negation of x square greater than x. And its negation means x square is not greater than x. So negation of the first statement will be there exists an x such that x square is not greater than x. So obviously it's very easy. There exists a real number which is 0.5
whose square is not like this, right? So you can change the symbols. So not equal to this, or you can say it like this, which is less than this. So because if you apply this negation on this, so this negation will change this symbol from this to this. Okay, so the symbol will also be changed. Fit and fine. So this will be 0.5 square is less than or equal to 0.5. So 0.5 square is 0.25. So second example is, there exists an x such that x square is equal to 2. If you take negation of this, will be negation of there exists an x such that x square is equal to 2. So it will be for all x, negation of x square is equal to 2. So this negation will change this symbol to not equal to. So you can say for all x, x square is not equal to 2. Okay. So this is how you can change for all to there exist. You can change negations like this. So next is using quantifiers for system specifications. For example, here we have a system specification which is every mail message larger than 1 megabyte will be compressed. If a user is active, at least one network link will be available. So first message is every mail message larger than 1 megabyte will be compressed. So that means for all mail messages where the mail message is larger than 1 megabyte is compressed. So you can change it. You can represent it like this. Let S, M, Y is representing every mail message, M, or you can say it represents mail message M is larger than Y megabytes. So this is representing SMY means mail message M is larger than Y megabytes. Now if I say S 2, 1, so it means mail message 2 is larger than 1 megabytes. Or if I say, if I change it like this, for all M, S of M, 1, S of M, 1, so it means all mail messages is larger than 1 megabyte. It means all mail messages larger than 1 megabytes, because we are talking about for all M, for all messages. Okay. And second will be compressed. Okay. So if I say a mail message will be compressed, so I have to refer to the email message, right? So I can say C of M A means mail message M will be compressed. So that means if I say for all M, S of M, 1, for all M, S of M, 1 is equal to C of M. So it means for all mail messages where mail message size is greater than 1 will be compressed, where mail message M is compressed. So repeat this again. If you do not understand it, repeat this again. So system specification given is like this. Every mail message larger than 1 megabyte will be compressed. So I said I've created two predicates here. First predicate is S of M, Y. It means the mail message M will be, mail message M is larger than 1 megabyte. Y represents the size. So if I say S of M, 1, it means the mail message M is larger than 1 megabyte. Now the second one is CM is equal to message M will be compressed, right? So if I want to say every mail message whose size is larger than 1 megabyte will be compressed. So we have to say for all mail messages larger than 1 megabyte implies that mail message will be compressed. So this way you can quantify, you can represent it like this. But again, this much is not required for the examination. This much is at least not required. Okay, you don't, but still it is good to understand this one. Okay. So in the same way, you can also change the second statement. Second statement is if a user is active, at least one network link will be available. So let me show you. So you can read the theory later on in your PPT to understand this. So how they have done this. So this is the first one, the quantification of the first one, and the quantification of the second one. So later on you can read. Okay. So this is again one more example. So we have three statements. So again we are coming back to the same, that we have a premise and we have a conclusion. So here we have first two premise: all lions are fierce, some lions do not drink coffee. So some fierce creatures do not drink coffee. So we have you can see the first two are premise. Premise is all lions are fierce. So I can say for all x, px, where px represents x is fierce. I can say for all lions, lions are fierce. Second is some lions do not drink coffee. So there exists a lion which do not drink coffee. So we can say some fierce creature do not drink coffee. So out of these two statements, we can conclude the third statement here. So I can change it this way. If I say, let us suppose we have a statement x, where x says x is fierce, I can write the statement qx, where x says x drinks coffee. Okay, and so with the help of these two statements, we can say for all x, px, right? So all x, if the value of x is a lion, so for all lions are fierce. So this way, for all x drinks coffee, so this will be negation of x. Negation of x is x do not drink coffee. So this way you can create some statements. So this is the statement. So you can say for all x, px implies qx. So if I have something like this, sorry, let me go back. So here we have, I guess, yeah. So we have px, qx and rx, where px is x is a lion, qx is x is fierce, rx is x drinks coffee. We have three statements. Again, read again. Px is x is a lion, qx is x is fierce, rx is x drinks coffee. So this statement makes px means x is a lion implies x is fierce, or you can say lion is fierce. And for all x, if x is a lion, the lions are fierce. Second is x is a lion, right? And rx is drinks coffee. So negation of rx is lion, it does not drink coffee, and means there exists a lion. So there exists an x such that x is a lion and lion does not drink coffee. So third statement will be, so if you remember qx, so qx means x is fierce. So there exists an x such that x is fierce and x does not drink coffee. So this way you can represent these three statements. Again, if you do not understand it, just try to argue with this again. So we had three statements. The first statement is all lions are fierce. Second statement is lions do not drink coffee. Third statement is some fierce creatures do not drink coffee. So what I said it, I've taken a px. Px means x is a line, and we said all lines are fierce. Qx is x is fierce. So we have said, say, if x is a line, then x is fierce. So here we can represent it by, if x is line, then x is fierce. For all the creature, if it is a lion, then it is his fierce. In the same way, some lions do not drink coffee. So there exists a lion. So there exists an x such that x is a lion and x does not drink coffee. In the third case, you can see x is fierce. There exists an x such that x is fierce and x do not drink coffee. So this way you can quantify these kind of statements, which these kind of statements, quantification of these kind of statements or representation of these statements was not possible with normal proposition calculus or normal propositions, but with the help of quantifiers you can even do this. Okay, doubts? Do you have any doubts, my friends, my dear friends? Do you have any doubts? If you do not have any doubts, just read this statement and try to express them with the help of quantifiers. In statements ko read karke inko express karne ki koshish kijiye. You have 2 minutes. Read all these 4 statements and try to represent them, try to quantify them and try to represent them. Okay, any solutions? Please write your answers. So here you can see we have 4 sentences. First sentence is, all hummingbirds are richly colored. Second sentence is, no large birds live on honey. Third is, birds that do not live on honey are dull in color. Fourth is, hummingbirds are small. So we have taken 4 statements. Px means x is a hummingbird. Qx means x is large. Rx means x lives on honey. And Sx means x is richly colored. So if you use them, then you can represent it like this. So Px is x is a hummingbird. And x means x is large. That means for all x, if x is a hummingbird, implies x is large. So you can say hummingbirds are large. Okay. Next is Qx. Qx, sorry, this is Sx, not, so Sx. Sx is x is richly colored. So it means for all x, if x is a hummingbird, then x is richly colored. Second, Qx means x is large and Rx means x lives on honey. So it means negation of this is there exists an x such that x is large and x lives on honey. So it means there does not exist an x such that x is large and x does not lives on honey. Okay, that means no large bird lives on honey. Third sentence here is Rx. Rx means x lives on honey and Xx means x is richly colored. So it means x does not lives on honey and x is not richly colored. So you can say for all x, x does not lives on honey and x is not richly colored. And then the fourth one here is x is a hummingbird implies negation of Qx. Qx is x is large. So if for all x, if x is a hummingbird, then hummingbirds are not large. So this way you can create these kind of expressions. So it's very easy to create these expressions with the help of some practice. With the help of some practice, it is very easy to create such kinds of expressions. Okay, I hope that you understood this part. Any doubts in this?
So before answering that question, let me show you some previous year questions on this. So this previous year questions file will also be emailed to you on WhatsApp. Sorry, on your Telegram group, this previous year question file will also be sent. Second statement here is, no large birds lives on honey. So here they are just talking about birds. They are not talking about hummingbird. Correct? And here X represents a bird. So here in the second sentence, they are saying QX means X is large and RX means that X lives on honey. So it means large bird and lives on honey. And here it says there exist. So negation of it means there does not exist any large bird which lives on honey. Okay. So you can take, see, this is, you can apply De Morgan's law in this. Yes, you can apply De Morgan's law and you can easily identify what you want to say accordingly. Okay. Let me show you some previous year question based on this. So this, this is just a PPT file. So this previous year question file will be sent to you on Telegram group. So this is the kind of questions that they have asked in the examination. I feel that you will be able to understand, you will be able to do them properly. First look at the questions, Devendra, then I guess you'll be more confident about this. So from this entire chapter, the first chapter they're asking A and A is equal to A. Which law is this? Is this adimportant law, De Morgan's law, identity law or complementation law? So they've just asked which law it is. So as you can see, it is very easy question. They're directly asking the law. Second is, if the proposition 7P implies Q is true, then the truth value of the proposition this P or P implies Q will be. So they're asking about which truth value of the proposition only, that this truth value will be true or false. Okay, so there might be some pending mistake that you can check. I think 7 should not be there. So it should be negation of P implies Q. This is not 7, I think this is negation of P implies Q. They are saying if the proposition negation of P implies Q is true, then the truth value of the proposition negation of P or P implies Q. So this means they are just asking if this is true, then what is the truth value of this statement? And you can say it is true, false, cannot determine or whatever it is. You can easily do that. Okay. Next one is, they are giving us a proposition which is P implies Q or and negation of P or Q or P. So we have P implies Q and negation of Q or P is equivalent to which of the following? You can just solve this to find whether you can just minimize this to find which one is, which is equivalent to which one. I hope that this is easy. This is from paper 2 June 2006. This question is from paper 2 June 2006 and paper 2 June 2000, paper 2 December 2011. So judge is asking the proposition negation of Q or P is equivalent to which of the following. Next is, so an example of a tautology is, which of the following is you are going to get a tautology? X or Y, X or negation of Y, X or negation of X, X is greater than equal to Y and X is less than equal to Y. So you have to tell this is equivalent to which of the following. So this is again saying the proposition negation of P or Q is equivalent to which of the following. So here there's some printing mistake again. So they are saying Q of X comma Y, where it denotes X plus Y is equal to 0. Let the two quantifications given as this. So they are giving, for this statement, they are giving some quantification. And where X and Y are real number, they are asking which of the following quantification, which of the following is valid. The first quantification is true or false. The second quantification is true or false. So they are already giving you quantification. They are asking the quantification for that. Okay. So again, you can see here, let Q, X, Y, Z be the statement X plus Y is equal to Z. And for this statement, they are giving some quantification that for all X, for all Y, there exists a Z, such that Q of X, Y, Z. And they are saying X, Y, Z are real numbers. Then which of the following is correct? Okay. Yes, you can apply laws to minimize. So I will send you, by the way, what I will do is, I will send you this file for practice. These are the previous UGC NET question. And after you have done practice, we'll take a class where we will be discussing the solutions of all these questions. Okay, because without you practicing, it will not be of any use. I will discuss all the previous year questions from GATE, UGC NET, BARC, DRDO, ISRO, NIELIT, and there are many examinations. So I will take previous year questions from all these examinations and we will discuss them in the classroom. So I will email you this file. You can practice with this file. You can solve all these questions from this file. Then in one class, we will discuss the solutions of all these questions. Okay. So you can see the questions are very, very easy. So again, they are saying which of the following compound proposition involving P, Q and R that is true when exactly two of P, Q and R true. So they're asking what is the truth table of this, and when two P, Q or R out of these three, when two of them are true, which of the following is true. So again, they're giving some proposition. So this is a uniqueness quantifier. So there exists a unique X, PX implies there exists a X, PX. Again, there exists a unique X, negation of PX implies negation of for all X PX. So they're asking what is the truth value of this proposition. You just have to create a truth value. Okay. So what I will do is I will send you this file first of all. You can use this file for practice purposes. Take this file, solve these questions. And after solving these questions, we will discuss these questions in the classroom. Is it clear? Is it fine? Do you have any doubts with it? Will it be okay if we discuss the questions in the classroom after you complete this file? I feel without you practicing, if I give you the proper solutions of all these questions, it will become like spoon feeding. That is why I want all of you to first solve the questions and then we will discuss your doubts in the class. Will that be okay? Great. Fine. So let us do one thing. I've already sent you the PPT for the lectures. This chapter was complete theory. Most of the things are like theory only. That is why there's so much content in the PPT. Okay. So I'm finishing the class right now. At this point of time, I'm finishing the class. I will send you this file. Maybe tomorrow I will send you the file. And on this weekend, we will discuss the questions. Today, this file is not ready. In Word file it is ready, but again there will be one more few changes in the file. So tomorrow I will send you this file, and maybe after 2 or 3 days, after a gap of 2 or 3 days, we will discuss these questions. Okay, tomorrow I will start a new topic. Most probably that topic will be interesting. So tomorrow I will start a new topic. You can take this file, you can practice. After 3-4 days, we will discuss all these questions in the classroom. Okay. I hope you understood all the topics. If you have any issues, any doubts with any of the topics, you can tell me. Or you can also message me on Telegram group or WhatsApp so that tomorrow I can first of all take your doubt. I'm finishing the class here. So go through the PPTs, go through the lecture again. If you have any doubts, just go through the PPTs. Tomorrow, just message the group. Tomorrow before starting the class, I will discuss all the doubts and then we will continue with the new topic. Okay. I hope this was fine. Devendra, we will take questions from last 5 to 10 years, and as well as we will also take questions from other examinations also. So not just 5 years, whatever the top questions which will be from this topic, I will take all the questions. I have a question bank of around like 5 to 10, 15 years. So I will take all the questions. So we will discuss all these questions in the exam, which is related. So I'll take all the related questions, okay? So I hope this session was useful to you. I'm finishing the session right now. And Chalo, all the best. Have a good night. We will meet tomorrow. Sweet dreams. Enjoy your time.